you, Jessica. My name is Emily Reed. I am a researcher with the Center for Changing Landscapes. And also, I'm one of the coordinators of this Climate Connection series. Normally, our CCL director, Mae Davenport, serves in this role as the host, and she could not be here today. So I'm filling her shoes. This series, just a bit about it, we launched this series in 2016 in hopes of really encouraging information exchange, collaboration, and networking among all the great people and efforts related to climate change and environmental work going on in Twin Cities. And very happy to be exploring a future of potential more collaboration with IonE in the series. So, like Jessica, I'm very excited about today's topic and the panelists that we have today. So I'm going to just go right ahead and introduce our first speaker, who's Patrick Hamilton. Patrick is the director of Global Change Initiatives at the Science Museum of Minnesota. He develops projects investigating the challenges and opportunities of humanity as the dominant agent of global change. And for example, some of his recent projects include a case study of a science museum as a case study in renewable energy, partnering with the City of St. Paul on energy efficiency and climate adaptation, working with the National Park Service to promote accelerated urban reforestation in the face of climate change, and co-leading the Science Museum's Water Planet Initiative. Patrick is also a board member of District Energy St. Paul and a fellow of this institute on the climate. So welcome, Patrick.
Thank you, Emily. And thank you all for persevering and being here on this soggy and dark morning. And I really appreciate being part of this conversation about the Mississippi River. I've been an aficionado on the river since I moved to the Twin Cities in 1980. It is a remarkable river with a wide variety of assets and a beautiful river. But I'm just going to focus on one asset, and that's drinking water. It's the supply of drinking water for St. Paul and Minneapolis and many of the adjacent suburbs, which means that it is supplying drinking water for 1.1 million people, or about one out of every three people living in this metropolitan area. So very important, and I would suggest that its importance for our source of drinking water is only going to grow in the coming years for a couple of reasons. One of them is that the population in the metropolitan area is growing. It's especially growing in the core of the metropolitan area, which is already being serviced by water from the Mississippi River. I also think that the demand for water from the river will likely increase as we continue to look at our groundwater resources and try to conserve them. There are areas where we know that we are drawing down the aquifer, and there are also areas where we know that we have groundwater contamination issues. So it wouldn't surprise me if some of the suburbs that right now are relying 100% on groundwater in the future start looking for opportunities to tie into the regional water distribution system that rely on the city river. So we're going to be talking about the urban river today, but from my perspective, I think it's really important to look upstream. And so that's my conversation this morning. My point of view is on upstream. And I'm going to talk about briefly about the past, the present, and the future. And first of all, the past. So if we go 100 years ago, circa 1918, there was actually a public swimming beach across the river from downtown St. Paul on Heard Island, even though there was no wastewater treatment system in the Twin Cities metropolitan area. All the raw sewage from this burgeoning metropolitan area was dumped into the Mississippi River because the operating hypothesis at the time was that the solution to pollution was dilution. This river was big enough to accommodate everything that we dumped into it. Well, that notion was put to the test a few years later when a lock and dam was constructed across the Mississippi River between South Minneapolis and the Highland Park neighborhood of St. Paul, converting what had been a free-flowing river into a 5-mile-long navigational pool and also a 5-mile-long sewage lagoon, creating a world-class public health menace. And something needed to be done, and fortunately, something was done. The Twin Cities coalesced around the construction of a wastewater treatment plant. And when it opened in 1938, on the Mississippi River just downstream from downtown. on the main stem of the Mississippi River, first before St. Louis, Memphis, Baton Rouge, New Orleans. And water quality immediately improved. But if we jump ahead to after World War II in the burgeoning suburbs and the growth of the metropolitan area, we saw renewed decline in the quality of the river water through the 50s, 60s, and 70s. And to make a bad situation worse, we had a large metropolitan area generating a large amount of waste that was overwhelming the existing sewage treatment plant. But much of the central part of the city had been constructed with combined storm and sanitary sewers. So every time it rained, whenever the snow melted, so much water would pour into the underground system that we ended up diverting raw sewage into the Mississippi River. So starting in the 1980s, we started making some massive investments in our wastewater collection and treatment system. We completely separated the storm and sanitary sewers. And if we look at the system today, it is one of the most sophisticated and effective wastewater treatment systems in the United States. Something we can justifiably be proud of. Now, that doesn't mean that there aren't water quality issues. Now that we have completely separated storm and sanitary sewers from one another, we no longer treat any of the storm water, and it can be quite dirty, and it gets discharged directly to the Mississippi River. And there is increasing concern about the fact that a lot of pharmaceuticals are slipping through the conventional wastewater treatment process and ending up into the river. But if we were to go up to Anoka, where the Mississippi River flows into the metropolitan area, and take a glass and dip it into the river, and then go down to where the Mississippi, just before it merges with the Minnesota River at Fort Snelling, and dump another glass of water into the river, and compare those two glasses, analyze the water quality, they are essentially the same, which is a remarkable achievement. And what it also means is that increasingly the water quality of this metropolitan area is dependent not so much upon the urban area, but increasingly about what's happening upstream. So let's look at upstream. So this is a land use map of Minnesota. Much of the landscape to the west and south of the Twin Cities is agriculture. And much of the growth in the Twin Cities is still forested. And this is where the Mississippi River originates. It originates in the lakes and forests of northern Minnesota. Winds its way down in a sort of a question mark pattern. When it gets to St. Cloud, increasing quantities of that landscape are agriculture. But a large part of it is forested, or it was. We have actually seen, for the first time in over a century, remarkable clearing of forests in northern Minnesota for agriculture. Growing of potatoes and other row crops. And we're talking tens of thousands of acres in just the last decade that have been converted from forest to agriculture. And I would submit that if this trend continues of converting forest to conventional agriculture, it is highly likely that the water quality in the river that flows between Minneapolis and St. Paul will decline in the coming years. So we're seeing land use change upstream of Twin Cities. And we're also seeing climate change. A large portion of the Midwest, upper Midwest, and New England are trending toward becoming wetter. And this day is going to be an excellent example of that. But superimposed upon this trend toward increasing wetness is increasing incidences of extreme rainfall events. Now, it's not that these events have never happened before. We have observational records of them taking place all the way back into the 19th century. But there has been a disconcerting streak of extreme rainfall events since the turn of the 21st century. And in fact, I need to update this chart because 2016 was the first year on record in which Minnesota had two extreme rainfall events in 1 year. This increase in heavy and extreme rain is one indication that our climate already is behaving substantially differently than it has in recorded history. Kenny Blumenfeld, state climatologist, office. So here are the present realities as we look upstream. We use that landscape to produce food, energy, and we expect it to also supply water. And we produce that food through agriculture. And increasingly we've seen vast amounts of areas of agriculture devoted to row crops. Two crops in particular, corn and soybean, are over overwhelmingly the crops grown in large portions of Minnesota. And we also use the river for conventional power generation. This is the Boswell plant, a coal-fired power plant up in Cohasset on the Mississippi River. And we know that from agriculture, we have water quality and water quantity issues. And from our power generation, we have carbon dioxide emissions and thermal pollution. As epitomized by the Sherco 1, 2, and 3 complex up in Becker County on the Mississippi River in Sherman County. And if we were to look at all the water used in Minnesota in 2016, irrigation is a notable use of water, but by far the largest use of water in Minnesota was for power generation. Not hydroelectric, thermoelectric, taking water out of our rivers, particularly the Mississippi River, using it to cool steam back into liquid water, and then discharging the water back into the Mississippi River. So it's not consumptive, but it definitely changes the nature of the water from when it take it out from where we put it back in. So if we look upstream and we think about the future necessities, what we want from that landscape, well, they're the same. Food, energy, and water. But we can't assume that the river's just going to deliver clean water, so that is something that we're going to have to be more intentional about in the future than we have been in the past. And we now know that we are living in an era of climate change. So not only do we need to reduce our carbon emissions in order to slow climate change, but also face the reality that climate change is underway and we need to adapt to the conditions that are changing. Which I say argues for looking for opportunities to help farmers economically and profitably grow other kinds of crops, permaculture, winter annuals, so that we can have a cover of vegetation on our fields year-round. Unfortunately, on the St. Paul campus here at the University of Minnesota, we have Forever Green doing exactly that, exploring how to commercialize a wide range of perennial crops and winter annuals in order to allow farmers to grow crops that are not only profitable, but also protect soil and water quality. Here's just one example. This is Kernza. This is a perennial wheatgrass. And it has many interesting qualities, but one in particular that has fascinated me is that in comparison to its annual cousin, it produces a very thick, long, dense root mass, very effective in helping to improve water quality as water flows through soils, and also, by the way, taking a significant amount of carbon out of the atmosphere and putting it back into the soil. We also need to transition from conventional thermoelectric burning of coal to generate electricity to renewable energy. Coal is going away. It's just a matter of time. It's not my opinion. That's Ben Fogg, the CEO of Xcel Energy, speaking in public 4 years ago. And I think even he would be surprised at what we've seen happen in just the last few years, an explosion in solar energy in Minnesota. We have gone from essentially no solar energy in Minnesota to 715 megawatts in the span of 3 years. Science Museum is the beneficiary of this expansion, and particularly of community solar garden. This is the solar garden that we subscribe to in Dakota County. We subscribed in spring of 2017, and we just analyzed the data for our first year of subscription. And the Science Museum Minnesota's share of the electricity generated by that community solar garden offset 36%. All our electrical use, and it's, by the way, saved the museum nearly $16,000. So I promise, here's the one and only multiple choice question of the morning for you. An acre devoted to producing solar electricity yields how much energy annually compared to the same acre devoted to growing corn for ethanol production? A, 25% less. B, the same amount, since both systems actually are benefiting from the same amount of sunlight. C, 200% more, or D, 1,900% more. Well, I've done the calculations, and I'll share them with anyone who's curious afterwards. 1,900% more. Which suggests to me that if we're going to use agricultural land to grow energy, which is essentially what we're doing right now, 30% of all the corn in the United States is used to produce ethanol, to do
blended with gasoline as a transportation fuel. If we're going to use that land to produce energy, why not use that land to produce a lot more clean energy that also has co-benefits of climate mitigation, adaptation, and clean water? So as we look upstream and think about future food and energy and how the two of them might knit together, this is the ground level view of a community solar garden. When you put one of these solar gardens on a landscape, you have to put something, underneath these panels. And the go-to approach nowadays is typically to seed them with pollinator-friendly perennial plants, which is highly desirable. But you can also graze under these systems. And in Europe, they're actually experimenting with doing agriculture under solar arrays. One of my colleagues, Sean Schaller, a research scientist at the Museum of St. Croix Water Research Station, in collaboration with Jeffrey Peterson and Lucia Levers of the Water Resources Center here at the U, they are doing research and will be presenting some of their results about the potential benefits of rural photovoltaics to climate adaptation at the November 14th Minnesota Climate Adaptation Conference taking place right across the street. So I hope that you can join us that day, in particular for our session that afternoon. And I'll just wrap up by saying that the future of our urban river increasingly will be decided by human decision making upstream, either by default or by design, either by accident or by intention. So let's imagine, design, and realize the future landscape that we all want. And I greatly appreciate being part of the conversation this morning. Thank you.
Our second speaker is Mary deLaittre. She's the manager of Great River Passage Initiative. She
entire length of the Mississippi River. We started in the Gulf of Mexico and landed up in Itasca. It was about two and a half months. We documented everything along the way. At one point, it was sent to the flood stage, so we had to go in vans rather than in boats. And of course, as you got up to Minneapolis, you had to switch to vans again because the big boat couldn't get up there. We documented every town, everything imaginable along the way, and it ultimately culminated with an exhibition at the Walker Arts Center. So I have been working on the river since then for just about the majority of my professional career. So here I am now managing the 17 miles of the Mississippi River for the city of St. Paul. I love this image. I just had to put it in there. This was 1952. This is in St. Paul. This is the old St. Paul Airport. So Old Man River won't stay away from our door. That's how it is. So St. Paul is at a very historic moment. There's this sort of harmonic convergence of many things happening. First of all, we have a new administration. The Carter administration started this year. They have introduced sort of three foundational philosophies that they are weaving into everything that they do in St. Paul. One is resilience, the second is equity, and the third is innovation. We at St. Paul are getting a lot of international attention. As a matter of fact, about a week ago, there was a conference that was held in St. Paul by a consortium of Scandinavian countries and Scandinavian corporations who converged in St. Paul because, as you know, on the federal level, a lot of countries and corporations are not working with the current federal administration. They're going straight to states and cities to cultivate business ties. So they converged in St. Paul because they see St. Paul as a very forward-thinking city, and they actually are very interested in setting up headquarters for their various green infrastructure, green energy, green technology businesses, and also providing expertise in all of these fields. So can you imagine St. Paul becoming sort of the hub of sort of green everything? Certainly in the Midwest. The other is, of course, the City of St. Paul's Climate Action Plan. This actually was started under the last administration, under Mayor Coleman, but under the new administration, they've done a variety of things. First of all, they hired Russ Stark to be the Chief Resilience Officer, which is an awesome hire. They have a goal. In 5 years, they want to reduce their carbon footprint by 21%, and they're gunning for 2050 to be a carbon neutral city. So they've got all of these sort of milestones that they're hoping to meet. Right now, they're really, after doing an inventory, they're really focusing their attention on buildings and transportation. Because as Patrick said, on the energy side of things, we're kind of good in St. Paul. We have district energy, and then Xcel Energy is also working very, very hard to transition over into renewables. And last but not least, we've got the Great River Passage Initiative that's going on. So what is the Great River Passage Initiative? Came out of the Great River Passage Master Plan, which is a master plan for the full 17 miles of the river flowing through St. Paul and 25 miles of river edge in St. Paul. This master plan had 321 projects called out. And I was hired very, very late in 2016 to put together a strategic plan and then start implementing the strategic plan to figure out, of those 321 projects, how do we go forward? You know, what is the strategic development for the Mississippi River in St. Paul? Our goal, really, is to better connect people to and along and across the Mississippi River, to create both human and environmental health along the river, to stimulate economic development, and, you know, probably most importantly, to create experiences along the river so that people value the river, they feel like they own it, and ultimately they're going to be the stewards of the river. And lest we not forget, the Mississippi River is one of the four great rivers of the world, and St. Paul is one of only two capital cities along the river, along with Baton Rouge. And St. Paul, with its 17 miles of river and 25 miles of river edge, makes it the city that has the most river. So we are truly accentuate that and accentuate people's experience there. So we're, this River Balcony project is really a sort of infrastructure project as much as anything. How do we bring people to the bluff edge, along the bluff edge, and down to the river, and focusing on three centers of activity? This seems to be sort of the theme of three centers of activity. Three centers of activity along the bluff. The first is where Union Depot is, where there's actually on-grade access to the river on Sibley and Jackson Streets. The second center of activity is the Ramsey West development that is will become underway. And the third, of course, is where the Science Museum is and where there is currently a sort of limping along parking ramp that may get rebuilt, hopefully, and potentially with a hotel on it or something else. And of course, there is access to the river at the Science Museum because when they were built, they created a staircase to get you down to the river. Finally, the third project that we're focused on is something we're calling the East Side River Initiative. Actually, Patrick referenced this earlier. There, if you see where Pig's Eye Lake is, this area is bound not only by the river to the west and the south, but also bluffs to the north and to the east. This is about a 2,000-acre area. It is unbelievably complex. You have two heavy industrial barge terminals. The area is crisscrossed by massive rail infrastructure. You've got the wastewater treatment plant. Along with that, you have the DNR headquarters down there. You've got regional park. You have, this is Dakota ancestral land, and so you have Dakota significant and sacred sites. And then also, it used to be the city dump, so it's a huge super, or actually, it's actually two Superfund sites. But if you were to go down there to stand in the middle of this landscape, it is the most beautiful and surreal experience because it's planted as if it were a combination sort of prairie and riparian landscape. And you look one way and you look over the sort of almost like industrial archaeology off and then off into the river. You turn the other way and you're looking over this landscape and you see downtown St. Paul and the Capitol and the cathedral. And of course, 60% of all migratory birds up the river go right through this area, and you've got beaver and coyote and all of this stuff. It is this crazy area. Our goal is to ultimately reconnect this area, create very, very sensitive destinations with this area, allow people, make it so people can orient themselves better to this area and it's safe. It's like the Wild West down there. And also trying to figure out how do we create an identity for this area because that does justice to the complexity down there. Okay, last but not least, we are a city-run initiative. I actually located within St. Paul Park and Rec, although we're kind of a free agent. We are creating a conservancy who's going to be the private fundraising arm for these capital projects. So we have some immediate challenges, of course, working on the river. And I was sort of hoping to show you two different pictures, but I'm going to just wing it anyway. This, our river fluctuations, either, you know, these days it's either like it's cresting or it's unbelievably low. That's sort of how it feels. I cross the Ford Bridge every single day, and that island right there is sort of my landmark, which tells me where's the river flowing today. You know, if you had crossed the bridge a month and a half ago, it was so high that only the little treetops were showing on that island. And then this photograph I took 2 days ago. So you can begin to see how the river fluctuates on a day-to-day, well, not day-to-day, but, you know. Well, you know, a lot of people are going out in little boats, so they're coming up river, and, mostly they're coming up river. But you can see, you know, this at least gives you a general idea of, you know, we have flooding and we have a very low river. River fluctuations are a really big deal. River fluctuations influence how business runs along the river. It's not just barge traffic, but it's a lot of, you know, there are restaurants along the river and that sort of thing. Parks, can we even have the parks open along the river? Infrastructure, flooded infrastructure is everything from trails to, well, you name it, frankly. And then programming closures. There have been many, many times this year alone where we haven't been able to offer programming down at the river because the river has been so high we can't even access it. We also have to deal with erosion and blowdowns. You know, not only is the infrastructure eroding a our sort of big immediate challenges. So what does that mean in terms of the Great River Passage Initiative? We have a very particular approach to sort of climate change and resiliency. First of all, it is interwoven in everything we do and all of the conversations that we have, okay? So we really take a comprehensive and integrated approach to climate change and resiliency for what we do. We take a very balanced approach to human and natural, human and the natural environment and health of those because, of course, they are interconnected and interdependent. One size does not fit all. You can't, for us anyway, every response we have is very project and site specific. There are very different requirements for doing things up at the Watergate Marina, Hidden Falls, Crosby area where we're proposing this River Learning Center versus down at Pigside. And last but not least, we have everything we do, flexibility is paramount. Not only flexibility in the short term, you know, how can you get things off the river if the river starts flooding, or how do you raise things up, or that kind of thing, but also how, whatever we do down there, is it flexible for the long term? You know, there's gonna be massive change in the long term. You can't just get rid of projects that you do and build new. That's a very expensive way to be approaching things and very wasteful. So we have to think in terms of flexibility. So we have, as we are beginning to understand and scope out these projects that we're proposing along the river, there are real questions that we are having to ask ourselves. The first one is, should we build? You know, you've got the East Side River District, which constantly, you know, it's got seasonal flooding that goes on, and you've got all the pollution that has not been remediated, and you've got significant and sacred sites down there. You know, should we be building at all? Same with the River Learning Center. We had to go through a technical study to see literally could we build down there because of flooding and because of its location. In the same vein, if we do choose to build, how do we build? So for instance, if we do build in the East Side River District area, do we have to treat it almost like the tundra, where everything floats there, pathways float, shelters to look at birds, they float. Down at the Hidden Falls Park, you know, we've got paddle share. We have to make sure that those buildings down there are actually movable so that when the floods come, we can move them. This question of how do we build is particularly pertinent over at the River Learning Center. Once again, we went through a technical study to figure out how to build, and it became very clear to us we need to build in a very modest size. Obviously, everything has to be elevated, and the building systems and materials that we use have to be very forward-thinking as well as responsive to what's happening on the ground. From an energy perspective, you know, we have these tunnels that the Ford plant built into the cliffs right behind us. What does that mean for geothermal? Can we tap into those very site-specific tunnels right behind us? So those are the questions that we have to ask ourselves and investigate. And then last but not least, we have to be thinking about programming. What kind of programming can we be doing along the river, knowing that we have change, constant change going on there? So for instance, if you guys know, there's Red River Kitchen located along the river in St. Paul. And that is, we think of that in our larger river balcony area. Well, Red River Kitchen can only exist in the current former industrial building along the river because it is a food truck that happens to use that space for people to sit in. And it has to remain a food truck rather than building a kitchen there because that building actually floods. So when the flooding happens, they can just relocate the food truck and put some chairs out in a slightly different location, which is great, you know. So for the majority of you, they can be in that building is used. But for the rest, you know, when we have these episodes, they just pack up and move to another location, which really has meant it's successful in a rather unconventional way. So these are really the critical questions that we have to ask. most of these instances, we're going through feasibility studies and raising funds to go into schematic design. When we have schematic design, we'll get the vision, we'll get the cost estimate, the phasing, the leadership, and all of that sort of stuff. And once again, go through that whole process to figure out, can we go, what is it going to be like, and that sort of thing. So, without further ado, that's it. I'm Kate Brauman, and I, first of all, promise to be fast, because I think all of you probably have questions, and what I'm most excited about is your questions and our conversation. I'm going to zoom us out a little bit and talk a little bit about what the Global Water Initiative is doing and why you should care if really what you care about is St. Paul and the Mississippi River, and then talk a little bit about climate data for planning, specifically here in Minnesota. So there are lots of things that water can and one of the reasons why I think water at the Institute on the Environment is exciting is because most of what we do isn't about water per se. It's about all of the things we do with water and all of the things that affect water. So this is a great place to come to integrate all the things that you think about that are affected by water or that affect water, which my money would say is almost everything. It's not that I'm trying to take over. So some of the work we're doing is looking at global water use and availability. And part of why this is important, especially as we think about climate change, is that there are places where we're using up almost all the water that we have. But there's lots of places where, in dry years, we're using up most of the water that we have. And that really matters because as we think about changing climate, our dry years and seasonal dryness are going to become more and more important. Part of what we do here at the Institute on the Environment is also really try to connect the great work that's happening within the academy to uses and applications outside the academy. So this is a screenshot from WWF's water risk filter, and I'm delighted to say that this map is actually the base data for this map. So you can go online as a business or as an individual, try to think about what your water risk looks like. They have a lot of different metrics, and this is one of the ones that they were actually able to ingest. We're also doing a lot of work here thinking about water productivity. So the University of Minnesota is a land-grant university. We spend a lot of time thinking about agriculture here. What do we use water for? Well, globally, we use almost 70% of water withdrawals are for irrigation. And so thinking about where we're using water, how effectively are we using it, and what are the impacts of that is also something that's really important. So this is some work we did with Bonsucro. They certify sustainable sugarcane, and they needed a water standard. So we worked with them to help develop a standard for sustainable water use in sugarcane growth. And then the third thing with water that's happening here at IonE is thinking about these land water connections. So exactly what Pat was talking about when we think about what's happening upstream. So some of my work is international. It is the Global Water Initiative. We're running a big project America working with some water funds where people are actually investing in upstream infrastructure and upstream land use change in order to improve water resources down in cities. So we're looking at the economics and some of the social impacts of that upstream, but also the hydrology, doing some measuring and modeling in those places. There's actually similar projects that are happening here in Minnesota. There's a Nature Conservancy
climate and land use here in Minnesota. So there's a project that I'm working with. It's led by Bonnie Keeler. She's owned at the Humphrey Institute, and Tracy Twine, who's in soil, water, and climate, where we're really thinking about a range of threats and then trying to translate those to water outputs. So what does climate change mean for water in the state? What does land use change mean for water in the state? And when we think about climate, this is really important. And most of my presentation is actually going to be questions to you, but I want to talk about a couple of things about climate data first, because it turns out that climate data is a pain in the neck. So this is an image from IPCC, the Intergovernmental Platform on Climate Change, and they have helpfully mapped out for us projections from, count them, 42 models. And if you look back at the past, what you can see is that the average of all of those models is closer to what we know about the historic period. So we can talk about the general trends of climate change. These suckers are all going the same direction. There's actually a pretty big difference between down here and up here when it comes to planning, when it comes to thinking about, is my building on the Mississippi going to flood? Or should we be putting agriculture in this place in the northern part of Minnesota? And you know what happens when we look at these forecasts is actually that you do a lot better if you have a whole set of these different climate projections. This isn't super surprising. We have a really hard time telling you what the weather's going to be like this weekend. It turns out that we cannot tell you whether or not it's going to rain on August 4th, 2043. So we have a lot of work to do, but we're also never going to be forecasting the weather. We're running big climate models to tell you that. And there's some interesting things that happen inside these climate models. The way they run, because they're running globally, they run at usually at something that's called two degrees. And what that means, if you look at the state of Minnesota, is that they're pretty big blocks. So we can sort of say, like, oh, this is what's happening in this giant block of Minnesota, probably. This is what would happen. This is what the outputs would look like for just one of those climate models. So some of the work that we're doing with that project that I was talking to you about is downscale. So we can tell you much more, with much better resolution, what does this look like? This is very exciting. This is also a pain in the neck. So the person who was producing these, they were actually produced by Peter Snyder. Most of our downscaling runs right now, I asked yesterday, take 40 days to run, to turn from this into this. And that's important because we need a lot of those data. So I'm delighted to be able to show you this. This is brand new, hot off the presses. This is just one climate model. And this is 3 months. This is runoff, average monthly runoff generation at the end of the century. So runoff in March, April, and May over the entire state of Minnesota. So pretty exciting. It did take 40 days for somebody to run and process this. That was after 2.5 years of spin-up. I'm very excited to be able to show you this. Did I mention that? So this was slow to get. And this is a boatload of data. So this is actually the mean value of 20 years of marches. And each one of these, you can sort of see in this, is actually a grid. So there's a whole lot of individual data points in that. And even these months actually are average values because those giant climate models run, they give you outputs every 2 hours. So we have summarized those first daily and then monthly. And then there's 20 months. And this is just for March, so there's 12 of these 20 months. And then I'm going to multiply that by 5 different models. And I've got that for the end of the century and the middle of the century, and also the historic stuff. So there's a lot of data. I can assure you that you don't want that. And so a challenge for us, but what I want to know from you is, what's the kind of summary that's useful? So this is the question that I'm going to pose to you, and then we're going to get everybody back up here, and you can ask us questions and tell us things, and we can talk to one another. So when I talk tell you how often a year that looks like this is going to happen, or the frequency with which that's likely to happen in the future. Is that a useful way to say, this is what the future is likely to look like? Remember the drought of 1982, that's going to happen more often. Remember the flood event, that's going to happen more often. There's lots of different ways we can talk about this, and so understanding how you would like to use climate data is really helpful to us as we think about how to summarize this, because I love you enough that I do not want to inflict those giant data sets on you. So I will end there and ask Pat and Mary to come on back to the front and please ask us questions.
So an extreme rainfall event in Minnesota is defined as 6 inches of rain or more over 1,000 square miles. And those have been on the increase since the turn of the 21st century. And so I think it's hard to quantify how frequently, but I think that we should not expect them to be as out of the ordinary as we thought about them in the past. And I think that we need to do modeling of our urban stormwater system what happens if 6 or 8 inches of water falls in 24 hours or less, and start anticipating what kinds of damage might occur if that event happens. Because they've been happening to the north of us, they've been happening to the south of us, and it's been a while since we've been the bullseye. But I don't think that we can count on that one forever. Duluth in 2012 had an extreme rainfall event. That community and surrounding communities scored $135 million in public and private damage after it was over. So I think that we need to start anticipating how we individually and as a metropolitan area brace ourselves for the implications of such events.
Well, the other event interesting about it, industrial agriculture, the pig sewage lakes are now overspilling. I know we have those up in Minnesota too. So, what's our risk? Are those up there as well? And what's the cost?
I think that's an excellent point. We have
the downstream.
We have feedlot, large scale feedlot, dairy, cattle, and hogs in Minnesota. And I don't know if we've done any modeling about what happens if 6 or 8 inches of rain falls over Blue Earth County in 24 hours. Are the sewage lagoons for these systems able to accommodate that much water? Some of these confinement operations are equivalent to, in terms of the sewage they generate, equivalent to a community of 10,000 people. There's a lot of waste being collected, and we certainly wouldn't want to have one of those overspill upstream of Minneapolis and St. Paul. Yes?
That's maybe kind of a nice segue into my question or statement is that we undo the damages of draining wetlands and floodplains, taking away floodplains and creating more storage capacity upstream, particularly upstream from the metro. It would help with water quality and water quantity. We wouldn't necessarily have as big a bounces in our after a stormwater event. So it, I don't know, this is more of a statement than a question, but it just seems like we've got to be pushing at the state level and even the federal level to try to get more best management practices. In our rural areas, I think, you know, Crow River watershed, Minnesota River watershed, those both contribute to the Mississippi, and we they've been heavily utilized for agricultural purposes for many, many years. And so it's changing the land use practices, it's creating more flood storage capacity in those areas. And then we wouldn't have as much water influx coming into the metro. We still have to do things here in the metro in terms of upgrading our stormwater systems and capacities, but it just seems like we haven't quite gotten there yet in terms of making the major investments we really need to make. So just that's what I'm saying.
I just thought about that, but
well, I was just going to make one observation because I think you make what you allude to is that critical connection between data and how we build. You know, that for me, that's where the data is extremely important, because it helps inform us not only should we be building, but what do we build and how do we build it. And I'm using build in the broadest sense of the term, if it is actual sort of human development type building, or if it's reintegrating the natural environment back into the urban environment so that there's greater balance there and greater mitigation and all of that sort of stuff. So from my perspective, the data that you're generating is terribly important to help us, to inform us about human development and that balance between human and natural environment.
I also think one of the things that's key to remember is that we're impacted by water that flows in lots of different ways for lots of different reasons. So we have one of these rainfall events like they had in Duluth in 2012. If it's raining like that on the city, it's going to flood. And it doesn't matter much about what was going on upstream. It's not that it doesn't matter at all, but we need to address that in very different ways than we need to address upstream flooding. And we need to do both of those things. It's not one or the other. It's really all of the above. And so thinking about land practices, they actually build tile drains now that have flappers so you can do flood storage underground in a tiled field so you still get agricultural productivity and also can do some controlling of runoff. That's not going to help when the bridges underneath the train bridges in Northeast, when it floods underneath all of them every single time we get a heavy rainstorm. We need to do both, and we need to think about all of these things. And it's doable, but not easy.
I'm going to throw one more thing in there, guys, because you also get to a very important point. In order to tackle a lot of this, both climate change and also how do we build these resilient sort of landscapes and all of that, it takes a different kind of leadership. Because ultimately, a lot of these decisions are being made by politicians and all. We need a type of leadership who can manage vast sums of information and distill that information down into a series of, you know, thinking about systems and all of that, and ultimately coming up with policy. That's a very, very, very different approach to things versus this, you know, this little piecemeal approach that politicians generally work on and all of that. So as you're going forward with your work, that's something to keep in mind, both in terms of your future careers as well as who you're choosing to vote for and all of that. We need a different kind of leadership to be tackling all this, so we're not taking more systemic approaches rather than piecemeal approaches.
So the question about the intersection of sort of flooding and some of the crowding systems that I was talking about. So you mentioned in the last 6 months that farm production in Minnesota is probably closer to 40%. And from maybe a city design transportation planning perspective, you know, it's we won't have much of our personal transportation leading on the weekends. Probably a relative, mostly electrified, that fleet. So in a reasonable lifetime of our farmer growing today, it's conceivable that 40% of their crop market is going to evaporate, and we need to replace that with something. So we could start to transition this landscape back to more perennialized cropping systems with or without sort of solar arrays on it. You guys modeled what that sort of scale of landscape change would mean for downstream hydrology in the, you know, sort of metro Mississippi River. Do you have a sense of how that would sort of bend those hydrological curves or reduce the risk of flooding frequency?
I haven't seen that for hydrologic.
I mentioned at the very end of my talk that Sean Schottler and Jeffrey Peterson and Lucia Levers are doing a research project right now to model the economics of whether taking marginal farmland out of the corn and soybean rotation and putting it into solar and other alternative, I'll say, widely defined crops. And if ethanol is a crop, then why not electrons? And so they're not modeling the downstream hydrological impacts. They're just modeling whether we are at a tipping point where we can start offering that to farmers as an economical alternative, particularly if you have 160 acres and you know that 40% of 40 acres of that is underperforming, then maybe that's an opportunity to put that into solar and get a guaranteed crop of electrons every day and payments, guaranteed payments every year, as opposed to having to rely on fluctuations of the price of corn and soybeans year to year. So they're modeling that on a very specific basis. But what I can say, I think qualitatively, is that anything that we do to put more permanent vegetation cover on our agricultural fields will have water quantity and quality benefits. But we also, I think, need to actually do more of the modeling of what the implications would be if we were able to accomplish that on a larger scale. Yes?
That raises a question about what do you think, has anyone sort of set what the upper limit of solar conversion is in Minnesota? I mean, yes, you could change that less productive field to solar, but do you have, you know, is the investment ready to go? Is the grid capable of handling it? What are sort of the upper limits of that energy conversion?
No, that's a good question, and I'm not sure if that modeling is, but what I do know is that the solar installations that we've seen, an explosion of them in just the last 2 years around the metropolitan area, many of them have taken advantage of the existing electrical infrastructure and have been sited specifically in close proximity to substations to reduce the cost of actually tying in and actually getting those electrons out onto the grid. As we move further out and look at more wide scale, I think potential solar, I wouldn't be surprised if we need to upgrade. But Xcel Energy and others, for example, did a very significant upgrade of electrical transmission several years ago. If you drive up I-94, that transmission line was constructed largely to bring wind energy to the metropolitan area from the Dakotas, southwestern Minnesota, and South Dakota. So I think that the cost of solar in particular has dropped so precipitously in the last 5 years that there's kind of a rush going on right now to look at the opportunities.
And I'll just chime in to say that this is outside of my expertise, but we have this awesome resource here at IonE called the Energy Transition Lab, and this kind of forward thinking about what's possible. So this is a great example of using the university resources in connection to questions of interest beyond the university. So both the modeling, but also these questions about what do the economics look like, what do the policies and governments look like that make that possible. So I don't have an answer for you, but take a look at ETL, because I think this is exactly the kind of thing that they're doing.
Carrie?
I was just gonna make a comment about political, you know, the new legislator type that you think might be needed. I still think there are opportunities right now to interject this kind of information to the state legislature through the Clean Water Council budget recommendation process or testifying before the Legislative Water Commission. Jim Stark recommended that. They are kind of prioritizing their budgets right now for what should be funded next session, and so they're open to hearing these kinds of long-term conversations, so you don't have to wait for the election.
Well, and you are absolutely right, and for me, my interest really lies in how do you take this information and synthesize it and get it to the decision makers so that we can start moving things, so they can make informed decisions that then have the repercussions that we want.
I'm really interested in thinking more about infrastructure and the river, and I think this might be specifically a question for you, Mary. Are you following the Army Corps' disposition study on the future of the locks?
And I knew somebody was going to ask that.
I'm just curious as you think about these three sites, and certainly what they decide will impact the way your projects are shaped. So
yes.
I'm curious if you. Your organization has taken a position on that, or what?
No, we have not. And, you know, actually, Trevor and FMI, you might want to follow up what I have to say. But just so you guys know, they're talking about taking out a couple of the lock and dams along between Minneapolis and St. Paul in order to sort of rewild the river. And they're at the very, very early stages of trying to figure out what, in fact, that means and what impact it would have not only on the landscape but on recreational use and business use, because of course in St. Paul we still have an active barge business going on, which then turns left at Fort Snelling and goes up the Minnesota River. So it's not just about us building, for instance, it's also the barge business along the way. We are keeping an eye on it. I think it's going to be a long haul before even any sort of decision is made about whether or not that's going to happen. But certainly we have to keep an eye on it. Do you
want to
say anything
you want to
add?
I think that I wish Irene was here from our office, because she sort of has been our front person on sort of lobbying and disposition studies, but I would just echo it's complicated. There are a lot of different factors that go into it. There's even some sort of water, climate, energy nexus with a couple different solar hydroelectric facilities on the river. So it is complicated, but those dams do sort of meter the river and turn a wild river into a series of pools that make it a little bit more predictably, and you take them out. The implications for downstream riverfront development are uncertain, and in already uncertain climate conditions. So we may have electrified cars everywhere before we figure out exactly how to handle removing those dams. It's also expensive to take the dam out. But on the flip side, these things were built, I don't know, 80 years ago with an 80-year lifespan. So concrete isn't going to last forever. It's been soaked in the river for a long time, and it will either need to get rebuilt or replaced or rebuilt in some way. So these are decisions, river management decisions, that will happen to us whether we want them to or not. And it is people, probably folks in this room, that are going to make a decision like that.
So I prefer
local
watershed districts, and we have recognized that we have the best understanding of how hydrology works within our boundaries, and are looking to really be a leader for our communities going forward to kind of help plan climate resilience and plan use of water. But as we do that, is there agreement or consensus on what future scenario the plan to, you know, that the master plan was done, that considered it, and okay, you said, you know, there's dozens of different climate models. So what is the, you know, is there agreement on what to plan for and how far ahead? And
so from sort of the technical climate modeling side, there's sort of two choices that you have to make. So one of them is, how far out do you want to think? Most of these models run to the end of the century, and so people look at mid-century and end of century. As Trevor mentioned, a lot of infrastructure and big building stuff has design lifespans of 40 to 80 years, and so that's actually a pretty decent time horizon to be thinking about these kinds of big investments. But you do have to decide sort of where you're looking, especially because a lot of the models really start to diverge the further out you get. The The other question is, how much warming do we think is going to happen? And the way that these models run and the scenarios that they're that they talk about now, they use something called representative computation. So basically, do you think we're looking at 2 degrees of warming in the future, or 4 degrees, or 8 degrees? And really, that's in some ways a social question as much as a technical question, which is what do we believe is going to happen in terms of controlling climate emissions into the future? If you're planning for a 2 degree warming future, I think you're crazy, personally, based on what we see happening right now. 8 to 8.5 degrees is like pretty dire, and you know the implications of planning for that are potentially much more expensive and much bigger than, say, planning for a 4 degree change. And there's not a right technical answer to this question right now. And so it's really about risk tolerance and risk aversion in terms of what that looks like in terms of internal planning. In general, I think it's good to have a sense of what all of the outcomes would look like, regardless of which future we plan to choose. I don't know in terms of if there's any technical guidance about for the locally for the cities or what, say, the Science Museum or the River Partnership is thinking about. But we haven't had that kind of conversation with those partners. You know, we're pulling data from the National Park Service, and the designers are pulling it from all over the place. So,
I'm guessing a lot of organizations are now using what's called the Atlas 14, which is the NOAA sort of guide to, you know, how we should be designing our infrastructure. However, my understanding is that is not forward-looking. So I guess that raises the question, what's going to be the next Atlas 14, if you're all familiar with that?
I'm not specifically, but I do think that, you know, there's sort of, to my mind, there's kind of two big questions that we're thinking about planning is, are we going to see something unprecedented? Are we going to see something that's totally different and outside the realm of where we've been before? And if so, what does that look like? How do we need to think about that? And or how are things that we know, things we've seen in the past but were unusual, those becoming more frequent? And we probably need to think about both of those things, but we certainly know what the extreme events of the past have looked like. And if we're building in a way that's responsive to that, it's unlikely we're going to go wrong with those choices.
You know, I'd like to make one observation, guys. You know, you're talking about what is going to dictate how we build in the future. And one of the things we don't talk about and has become very clear with Florence is insurance companies. You know, it's going to be the insurance companies, guys, and those kinds of organizations that are going to start to dictate how are we going to be building in the future. Because they're the ones that are losing their shirts. You know, the $40 billion rebuilding of North Carolina and South Carolina, and the same thing with Texas. And it's just going to keep getting worse and worse and worse.
I'll also add that these really major events obviously matter. We want to think about them. The sad fact of the matter is that when something as bad as Florence happens, that's when you do get the federal government stepping in. Maybe not so effectively. You do get insurance companies stepping in with payouts. There's also, it's not just the very extreme events that are going to become more frequent. It's what maybe we think of as nuisance flooding, really big things that aren't catastrophic becoming much more regular. And often those aren't sufficient to flip the switches that get big time aid, but it doesn't mean that they're not expensive, and it doesn't mean that they're not damaging, and it doesn't mean that people don't die. And so thinking about and planning for more frequent bad but not catastrophic events is also something that's incredibly important as we think about climate change and water in the future.
So
So a quick anecdote, my parents bought their house in Moorhead back in the early 60s. And they had a finished basement like they all did. And then in the 90s, there was a series of extreme rainfall events that forced the backup of the sewers into their basement. And it happened suddenly. It was happening every 1 to 3 years. And it actually forced them out of the house. Not because the damage was catastrophic, but they were older, they were elderly, and suddenly the stress and the anxiety that every time it starts to rain, is this going to be something that's going to push the water back into the basement? And so I think to the point, you don't need 8 to 10 inches of rain to cause a lot of problems. And in a metropolitan area like this where we rely on the underground stormwater drainage system to whisk that water away. Now, one of the things that I've been encouraging people to do is adopt a neighborhood storm drain and keep it clear of debris, because the water doesn't go down the drain. It's going to go somewhere, and it's likely going to end up in someone's basement if it doesn't. And I think that we just, one of the rule of thumbs that we have in our household personally is that if you're going to store something in the basement, either store it in a bin, or if you put something in the basement, don't be distressed if it gets ruined. And don't throw anything in the basement if it'd be a catastrophic loss for you. Pictures, memorabilia. So I think there's both personal and municipal scale responses to these increasingly frequent events.
I was just gonna say, we talked about the length of the climate record, and really have a longer history of climate to reflect on. And in Minnesota, we've had major movement of the prairie forest boundary because of drought conditions that lasted for centuries. It was all the way east of the headwaters of the Mississippi and over towards Grand Prairie, Wisconsin. So that much of the state was in dry conditions, prairie conditions. It looked, if I'm understanding your maps, it looked like the Red River is going to become drier and potentially the headwaters of the Mississippi. And just the scenario, I mean, we're focused on these rain events, but the Twin Cities could just as easily suffer greatly from a lack of water in the Mississippi, and, since that is the major source for drinking water. So that should be also on our minds for these scenarios.
Definitely. I think that, both the modeling and what we've observed to date is a trend toward increasing wetness, but that does not mean that droughts will not happen in the future. And we could have one of the concerns, I think, among hydrologists and climatologists is whether we have increasing periods of dryness and then extreme or heavy rain and then more periods of dryness. And that can certainly cause water supply problems. I was living in the metro area in 1988 when we had that extreme drought. And up the St. Cloud, you could walk across the Mississippi River. And it was a very serious issue in terms of whether Minneapolis in particular, because St. Paul can tap wells for backup. And we've also had instances in recent years where the flow of the Minnesota River dropped low enough that it curtailed the power generation at the Black Dog plant because they were pulling water out of the river for cooling the plant. And so we can have, even if we trend toward increasing wetness, we could certainly have periods of extreme dryness that pose significant issues for water availability.
That was kind of my question, is currently there's a lot of groundwater withdrawal in the metro area for water supply, and then there's realization maybe we thought it was infinite, but it doesn't look like it is. We may have some shortages, so there's been a bit of a push to move it over to surface water like Minneapolis and St. Paul are for the whole metro area. Be a major shift, but I was wondering if anybody's really been looking into that specific question of, with predicted dry spells, I mean, is that also going to be constrained so it's not an infinite? I think a lot of people look at that as sort of an infinite source. It's a big river, we should be able to withdraw anything we want for a water supply, but I'm curious if anybody's really looking at that question and quantify that.
Not to my knowledge, but the one thing that would be great about a shift like that is that these municipalities wouldn't lose access to the wells that they currently have, even if they weren't in regular use. So just as stay here and talk to one another and talk to us. We haven't completely finished the donuts back there as far as I can tell. So thank you so much for joining